the version that we wanted to create, modifying things by hand, etc. But we found that this is not a scalable way to release these two different images were totally different, to be installed by different people with different configuration, etc. So what we are doing now is modifying images, modifying already created images for us in an automated way. There are lots of ways of doing images. There are lots of people that prefer to create the image from start. They have like a recipe on what's going to be the image and then create them. There are people using Beard Install, some other people using Packer.io, Foreman, etc. I don't recommend Beard Install because Beard Install, I recommend Beard Install, but there's another tool called Beard Build that is faster, but I don't recommend it because it's not creating an image from scratch, but using an image, that a base image that was created by the creators of LeapDSFS. The other ones are okay. Sometimes modifying images is convenient. For example, if you already have like 200 VMs running, and there's like a security advisory that you need to upgrade some SSL packages, etc. You can modify the base images so the new virtual machines created from these images already have these fixed, etc. Or if you already have you need some requirements for new machines, like for example a special tool for your company inside, you can modify these already created images. I'm going to talk about Qcloud 2, but the thing is that you can convert the image to whatever you want. If you're using VMware, for example, you can convert it to VMDK. This is if you don't know Qcloud 2 or you have been using it a lot, I'm going to give you some information on what can you do with Qcloud images. Qcloud images. They have more things, but they have some metadata telling how big is the cluster, which is the parent, etc. It has a cluster map saying that this block in the disk is baked by this block in the Qcloud image. And then it has the cluster data, that is the blocks that are in the image. This is nice because if you have a 10 gigabytes file or 10 gigabytes image, hard disk, you don't need to have 10 gigabytes information in the file. You only have the blocks that are written in there. So you will end with a really small image for the total size. And this is the command that you can use to create the Qcloud 2 image. Normally you use the QMYMG. Create minus F, that is the format, Qcloud 2, the name of the image, and then the size. Another way you can use Qcloud 2 images is creating a delta from a parent image. For example, you have a CentOS 7. You can create a delta from this CentOS 7 and install MySQL, for example, in this image. This other image will only have the modifications from the parent image. So it doesn't. The size of this image will only be the modifications from the parent. To create the image, you can use QMYMG, create, minus F, like before, saying that it's going to be a Qcloud image. You specify an option saying that it's going to have a backing file that is the parent. You name the base Qcloud 2 that is going to be this image, and you create the new one, image Qcloud 2, that is going to be this one. You can also specify the size. If you don't specify the size, you will end up with an image that is representation of a disk with the same size as the parent. But you can also specify the size. So you will end up with a bigger file, a bigger hard disk if you want.
Is the size just stored as metadata, so could it be updated later?
It's just metadata, yes. It's easy to grow, but not that easy to shrink. Then you can convert Conversion can be done from one format to another, but you can also use convert to get a delta image. There should be another box here, but I run out of space. You can convert this image that is just the delta from the parent to a full full disk with all the information from the parent and this one. If you use a QMOMG convert without debugging path, it will cram all the information in this new image. If you copy a QCow2 image to another one and start a new new VM and do some modifications, you will end up with an image that has some data from the old one and some modifications too, so it will grow. The thing is that you already done that and you want to come back to a delta, you can also do that. You already did the copy, do some modification in this image, but then what you want to have is the difference between this image and this one. If they come from the same parent, they will have a lot of blocks that are the same. So you can use one of these two comments to end up with this image. That is only the difference with the parent. There are two, these are a bit different. If you do a QMO IMG rebase of an image, for example this one, you won't get a new image, but you will modify this one, so you take out these blocks. The problem is that to take out these blocks, it will tell the file system that these blocks are not allocated in the file system. So you will end up with a sparse file. This is nice, so it won't buy space in your hard disk. But if you use SCP, for example, it won't know that this is a sparse file and will occupy the full thing. So I usually create a new one with this command. So it will end up with a normal file with only the blocks that are different from the first one. Normally people use one of these methods to modify images. First one is the mount with the magic number 32256 to mount the first partition. The number is 512 multiplied by the sector when it starts. And then you can go there and modify the files that you want to modify inside the partition. Another way to do that is using a loop device. With loop device you can get partitions and just mount like a normal partition. And then you can use NVD, that is network block device, I think. You can use QMU NVD, that is a driver that knows how to understand some format, like for example QCow2, and give a raw device that can be used to mount or device. I'm not using this system, I'm using libgestfs. Libgestfs is a library and a set of tools that do a lot of things with images. This is from the web page. But you can do a lot of things, as you can see. Edit files, get the list, use some free statistics, create the best, convert from one from physical to virtual, or from one virtual format to another, etc. The most common utility that people use is to get information and write things inside the images without mounting. The utility is called GuestFish. GuestFish is an utility that most of libguestfs work like this. They start a new VM with that has drivers to interact with lots of file systems and a lot of disk image formats. You can say you normally start GuestFish means to say the image that you want to attach to this special VM. It will let you run some commands to mount this partition in slash, or mount this partition in slash md, or whatever you want. But with ESI, you will try to figure out the partition scheme. So you will try to mount the partitions how they are supposed to be mounted. After that, you can run commands. For example, you can open this image and cut this dot file, or edit this etc service. After you exit, you have the image modified, and you can run another virtual machine with this image modified.
And the difference between the mount or using the web page could be the interaction with the virtual machine?
At the end of the day, we're doing the same thing. But guest piece is just doing all these steps for you. You can also do other things. You can script things. Like, for example, here I'm passing this little script. These are guest fish comments. Like, upload the fileservice.com to indcservice.com. So you can do the same, run the same script in a lot of fields. You can also create a tar file. And tarring means uncompress this tar file with the tar script. And there's another thing that you can do that is really convenient when you have a virtual machine that is running, but you cannot enter or is behaving erratically, and you want to read something from the VM. You can say guest fish -- RO, that is very important, read only, because the machine is running. -i, so it figures out how to mount things. You say the libvirt URL you want to connect, and the name of the VM, and then you can do things inside. For example, cut the log file, so I can check what's happening inside the VM. The other tool that we use a lot is virt customize. Virt customize can be used to change a lot of, to automate changing a lot of things of the VM. Things can be move files, install packages, change passwords, create users, etc. We're not supposed to be to read this, but this is the help of the comments. You can see that it has a lot of parameters that you can use to change things. It can even modify Windows registry. So if you want to create a new user in Windows, you can do it. But the thing I like it most is that you can execute scripts while these disks are mounted. And this is what we use in OpenNebula. OpenNebula distributes some images. These images have some special configuration, so we work with OpenNebula. One of them is that they have OpenNebula context packages. OpenNebula uses a system of network configuration and some other operating system configuration that reads information from the CD-ROM and uses this information to configure network, to configure start scripts, modify DNS, etc. So to do that, we need to install a package inside these images. What we've started to do is to use the CentOS images that they provide the web page. The thing is that we have to do images for several distributions, several versions, etc. And who is going to know more about how to create an image in CentOS than the CentOS guys? So we get these images, and we modify a couple of things from these images. One of them is install the context packages and modify a couple of things. And to do that, we create a CD-ROM with some packages that we want to install inside this image. We install them. We remove the Cloud Init and Network Manager packages because we have some incompatibilities with it. We install the EPL repository, and we install robot packages, so the machine is able to grow when it starts. This can be done manually, but with customize is really easy.
Javier, just one question. Why do you want to do that when Cloud Init is already in the base image?
Because
it's not
because Cloud Init doesn't support everything that we support in OpenAV packages.
Okay. We can speak about that later and probably with the Cloud Init people or even patches that we can integrate.
Yeah,
in
the thing is that
distribute.
We've been trying for years to integrate things in Cloud Init and somehow I'm not able to. I have an open ticket since 2 years ago. I didn't have any yes or no, just that.
It's just support. Okay.
I'm sending emails to the support and I cannot move it forward, so
okay.
I have to do something.
Yeah, obviously.
First thing we do to modify these images is creating this sage ROM with the packages that we want to install. In this case, it's the images that we create. We have some images in GitHub. Normally you just pull the images in the seed ROM, but I'm showing you that if you have binaries in GitHub, you can use the API and this command that is great, JQ. This is like a next path for JSON.
Yeah.
And you can get in the assets, the browser download URL, you get all of them. You just pass it to wget and get these packages. In this case, it's packages, but it can be a GIF, it can be an XML, or whatever you want. The good thing is that I didn't have to modify anything every time I create a new package. I just fire up the script, download the latest packages, and just create the CD-ROM and do the other stuff. The real creation of the CD-ROM is this one. Probably you know the gen ISO image. The important thing is that I'm calling this I'm labeling this CD-ROM extra and adding inside this CD-ROM all the files that are in the repo directory. Next comes the script I'm going to run inside the inside this build customized PL. First thing I do is I'm creating a temporary directory. I'm mounting the extra label extra CD-ROM in the directory, and then I do the usual stuff. Install the packages, remove Cloud Init, the network manager, installing the third release, Cloud Init, Windows 4 part, etc. I'm using the no GPG check because I had some troubles, and I don't want to say yes to this GPG case. I will let the user do that. So it's more pristine. It's more similar to the original CentOS image than if I change other things. And then one of the things I usually do when I modify an image is I never modify the original image. I don't do that because sometimes I don't do it well, and maybe I have to download the image again. So what I do is an overlay. Do you remember the qcow command to create an image that has a parent? I'm doing that. And after that, I call git customize, say that I want this image attached to the build that's going to run. I want to run the script that I've shown you before. I'm also saying that it's going to be qcow too. And minus V is only that you will see everything that is running inside the VM when it starts, so it's nice for the loading. Saying that I'm going to use this image, I'm adding this image to the VM. And for example, I can say in the case of CentOS, it doesn't have a password, but right now with this comment I can say good password is going to be disabled, but I can also for debugging, for example, I can say good password is going to be something. So I can try this machine, entering this machine knowing that there's a password. And after that I end up with an image, or kick out to image, that is a delta, that I can try. And when I'm sure that this image is really working, I can use the QMOMG convert to create a QCOW2 image with all the information, or create or convert it to VMware or to RHEL, whatever format I need. In the second phase, I do an optimization. This is something that you is not only for images that you have modified, but for images that you already have. One of the things that happens is that you create RPM, and for example, you download some RPMs that are in the cache of CentOS when you start something, to do YAML install or whatever, starts to download things. And even if you delete these RPMs, this data is still in the disk, because when you delete your, you don't zero the blocks. And that's where this optimizing comes. So the thing is that there's this build sparse file. There's another tool of guestfs. And what it does is zero the blocks that are not really used by the file system. And in some image, the difference between normal image and build sparse file, if you really use the image, is really, really huge. Build sparse file can run in two modes. One is the normal specification, if I can call it like that. And the other one is the place specification. Normal specification, what it does is creates a new image and writes zeros in all the empty spaces, or all the empty blocks. In place specification, it gets an image and modifies and allocates the blocks that are not used by the file system. In normal specification, it creates an overlay image and creates a new file and fills this file with zeros. When it reaches the maximum file size that it can write, you will end up with all the blocks that were free with zeros. After that, it deletes the file, so the file system is not full anymore. It also writes zeros in subpartitions. And after that, it converts this QCOW image to another one. And QMONG, when it finds a block that is all zeros, it just skips it because it knows it's zero. So the command is this one. One of the things is that you have to take into account is to change the TMP view. The thing is that when you do this command, the intermediate image will occupy the full size of the disk. So for example, if you have a 10 gigabytes QCOW2 disk, it will occupy 10 gigabytes. If 100 gigabytes, it will be 100 gigabytes. And normally TMP is memory. I don't know you, but in my laptop, I do not have 100 gigabytes. So, well, you do that, and you will end up with this file that has all these zeros. There's the other way that's in place. This is relatively new. I don't remember which QM support it is.
1.6.
1.6?
What did you got? 1.5 for row 5.
I think it's supported in CentOS 7. I think it's 1.7.
I don't know the current version. I think they are into something already. Actually, I don't know in CentOS.
But CentOS 7 supports it because I tried. So if you're using it, it works. What it does is uses the trim command. Most of you have an SSD in the laptops, and the SSDs are not only the SSDs, but right now we are using a lot. The string command to tell the SSD which are the empty blocks. The thing is that the operating system can't do that because the operating system has this information, has the file system information. The good thing is that you don't have to zero everything. You can just tell the underlying hypervisor, for example, that there are some blocks that are not going to be used. So the hypervisor or QEMU driver or I don't really know who's doing that, is freeing in the file system these blocks. But I'm saying that they are free. The thing is that this is a bit different for, because you're modifying the image that you're saying I want to strip empty space from it. But the thing is that you end with a file that is sparse. It's a QCalcul file with holes in it. That is OK. But the problem is that it's not good for distribution. For example, I think that tar supports sparse files. But if you're copying it to another place and you're not using the write tool, you will end up with a file that occupies what was occupied before. One of the good things is that you don't need this full space to create this, to delete the blocks. So if you have a 1 terabyte image, maybe it's just 1 terabyte, but you're saying that the maximum size is going to be 1 terabyte. You don't need a 1 terabyte space in your hard disk to create a sparse, to run this sparse file. It just deletes these blocks and that's it. And if you're using this method, it's better that you convert this image to another one without holes. So you just put all the blocks at the beginning. The other thing that you can do with this method is using compression. The thing is that if you run it this way, you can also add --- compress, and you will end up with a QCalc file, but the blocks are compressed. More or less half of it.
There's also, instead of creating an empty file filled with all zeros, you can also use a command called fstream, which will basically do the same. You don't need to create the file filled with zeros.
Yeah, that's what in place is doing.
Oh, okay.
It's calling the trim command, so the QEMU knows that it can trim.
Oh, so you do that inside of the guest.
This is what the command is doing.
Oh, okay.
If you call it this way in place, it's using fs trim.
Inside of the guest.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, if you're doing.
Yeah, I mean, because you can call fs trim inside of the guest instead of creating the empty files and
removing
them.
Is it
the same?
Yeah, it's the 2 ways they do it. But this is not something you are doing. This is what it does. Just say in place, and that's it. Then after that, you can compress the image. But sometimes, okay, if you have your images in your laptop or you have the image in your cluster, whatever, maybe you don't care that much about the size. But if you are distributing it, like for example in CentOS, or we are distributing these images, people don't want to be like 2 hours waiting for the image to download. So you want it to be as small as possible. Well, not really as small as possible, but small. QCalc2 images and can have the blocks compressed to make them much smaller. Compression, I think it's using libsyn that they're using. It's not the best compression. It's in, if you compress the original image with the XSEED or BCBU, it's going to be much smaller. But the drawback is that when you download the image, you have to uncompress it and then use it. The good thing about using QCalc2 compression is that you can use the image as is. You have this compressed image, you create an overlay, and start new with the machine. And for lots of cases, it's okay. The other problem it has is that it needs some CPU time to uncompress these blocks. So if you want the machine to be VM to be fast, denial, etc., maybe it's not good because you're taking out CPU cycles from the host. And if you're using the not in place sparsify, you can just use it compress the output. Then some tips that you have to take into account. First one is that there are two or three QCalc2 formats. After, I think it's 1.10, there's a new format that is the default one. So when I started creating images in my laptop, I put it in our cluster and it didn't work. course, in my life. Always. So Chrome was this, this version. CentOS doesn't support new version, but supports the old one. So when you create or you convert, you need to specify WinSaw compat 0.10 so the images are compatible with all systems. There is another thing that they fixed in QMO 2.4 that I think is the most recent one. You cannot create delta images with compression. Maybe it's a bit, if you're not using that, but if you're using that with 2.4, you can use this feature. It's compatible with all QCallo 2 images. The thing is that QMEMG was supposed to do that, but somehow in the code they were not doing it properly. But if you create the images with the compression, a delta image with compression, it works with an old QMEMG. Most of distributions don't have this version, it's present. But you can just download the QEMU code, configure, and make QEMUMG. This way you will only compile this tool. It doesn't need a lot of dependencies. It's not going to compile anything about emulation or anything, just code. I think that's it. The only one thing I want to tell you is that I'm working in a tool. Maybe you know Docker registry? I'm working on a tool to do something like that, like Docker registry, but with QCallo 2 images. Sometimes you have a CentOS 7 master image, and you create a new image with MySQL, another image with Apache, another image with something. And the difference between these images are very tiny. So, this tool, what it does is that it has a tree with the deltas. So you can say, I want this Apache something, and it will download all the deltas and toolparents and create the big file. So a way of distributing the images in Java.
Can you make it easier than in the Docker thing to run the interchanges, differences?
I'm sorry?
Can you make it that if you're building something like that, can you make it easier to review the changes between the single versions?
Right now, I'm just making the prototype. I have one in Ruby, and I'm changing that to Go. Mm-hmm. People are telling me that you have to do Go. But I suppose it's going to be downloadable in a month or something like that. I will give you my card if you're interested, and I will send you an email from this way. That's it. Do you have any question about it?
All day newly image in the Nebula markets is
This is a personal project. If it works, maybe we can use it in Open Nebula, but right now it's just doing that. It's not even tied to Open Nebula. I didn't have a better finishing.
Well, thank you, David.